Virgin Mobile Sweet Pay is an affordable way to pay for a cool new phone so you can go from...
Just looking online.
To...
How much is this one?
To...
Ooh, I'll take this one.
Wait for it.
And I still get member benefits?
Yes. Sweet Pay gets you a hot new phone for $0 down. It's 0% APR and 24 low monthly payments on affordable two-year rate plans from $45 a month. Plus, get deals on fashion and entertainment with member benefits. Visit virginmobile.ca for details. Some extra charges apply. Virgin Mobile. It's better to be a member.
Greetings, my fellow friends of the future. It is I, one of your hosts for this evening's show. This is Future Imperfect, a collaborative project between ThisWeekinGeek.net and, of course, the Geekcast Radio Network. I am Mike the Birdman Dodd, and I'm not alone as we trek across space, time, dimensions, and perhaps something else. We are here to celebrate cool things. We're actually going to be pitching our own sci-fi shows this evening. These could be ideas that are of whole cloth that we have created with our own little hands and minds, or they could be reboots of franchises or shows that maybe only lasted a season, maybe a couple of episodes in some cases. So it's going to be a variety of different things you will be experiencing tonight as you're joining us here on Future Imperfect. But of course, I'm not alone. As I walk the decks and the halls of the USS Future Imperfect, I am joined with Admiral Stephen Phillips. Welcome, friendo.
Heyo.
And of course, we are now joined with regular, oh my God, he's moved up from guest star. We have writer and now podcaster, Aaron Pollyea.
Hi, how's it going, everybody?
And it is my ever-lovable co-host, the guy who tries to rein me in more often than not, the man from Kitchener.
I was going to say, rein you in, Alex. I generally used to be you had to rein me in. Now I'm like, Michael, stop it. Michael, stop it.
Yeah, you're like, you say first.
Is it worth it?
Yeah, you're like, Mike, for the love of God, stop giving your manifesto. So yes, guys, we are here on Future Imperfect this week. We are going to be talking about something, like I said, rather fun. We're going to be pitching our own original sci-fi ideas to you. So this idea was brought up by Aaron a few weeks ago. We have a kind of group chat that we talk on Facebook, kind of throwing different ideas, sharing memes back and forth. And Aaron would have been about 2 or 3 weeks ago mentioned, hey guys, why don't we do our own sci-fi show. So that got the ideas and creative juices kind of flowing between all of us, because all of us have some background of creative experience. I myself have been a role-playing game player for many, many, many years. I've written some short fiction, none of which exists anymore. It was all written down in good old line notebooks back in my high school days. I mean, I have written some blogs online, but they're lost to time. They're mostly journalistic pieces anyway. So this was a fun time to kind of pull out my creative ideas, to pull out something kind of neat for this. But I've got, I'd say, about 25 years of creative experience, if you can really kind of call it that. I'm nowhere near as cool as Aaron, who actually has published things that you can buy on store shelves. But this will be a fun thought experiment between all of us. So Steve, what kind of experience do you have kind of bringing to this?
Well, I used to actually write a lot of fanfics back in the day, of just popular series or games. Back in, like, what was it, middle school, my friend and I wrote a Mega Man X Dragon Ball Z crossover series, which I still have the Word documents. They're not very long, but it was quite humorous to see how that world comes together. And I wrote a couple of Transformers ones that I kind of created a whole new, I basically retconned all of Beast Machines and wiped it out and redid with my own series. And then I, in college, I wrote a screenplay, creating my own kind of sci-fi universe, with my own superheroes and people involved and villains. And, I kind of came up with a lot of those ideas while I was taking some edx.org Smithsonian classes that they had. Michael Uslan and Stan Lee kind of coordinating and teaching how to, you know, basically craft your own universe.
And then moving along next, Aaron is probably our most accomplished person around the virtual roundtable this evening. Aaron, I guess, where did you start kind of with the creative space with you?
Well, I started with art, believe it or not. I started with a little bit of computer art, even though I'm kind of terrible at it, but I had access to a lot of programs that I could like kind of layer together and do that. But that got me into the writing business when I started writing little short pieces for Planets for BattleTech. Wrote a lot for BattleTech, quite a few different pieces for that were fluff, you know, or background information on planets, some of the wars that occurred in BattleTech. Then I got into Star Trek. Lots of writing for Star Trek lately, that's for sure. I've done some work on some novelization type stuff in the background. I've never really progressed very far in it because I'm never very happy with my dialogue, let's put it that way. But I have a few worlds that I've been kicking around in the background that I'd like to actually put out a novel for. I'm just not really confident enough yet with the dialogue or the plotting of it. Let's put it that way. I guess I'm very self-critical.
Okay. And then finally we will bring things to Alex. Where does your creativity start?
Probably if we want to go really far back, we're talking like kindergarten. You know, you'd make your own little fan fiction drawings and in your, like, we had to have journals, right? Before each day we bring in dream journals and different things. So it was all like Transformers and spaceships and whatever weird stories there. I think I have a couple stories that we dictated out to a teacher's helper that they would type up on the computer and it would print on the dot matrix printer. I think my mom has them. I had one where, an alien ship landed on or around Frankenstein's castle. And I'm like 6 years old, and it was, you're supposed to write a 2-page thing, and they ended up printing me, I think it was 35 pages. And like I was dictating it, like I had the whole story mapped out in my head, and I dictated it to the teacher's helper, and they typed it all up, they printed the whole thing, and I think I still have it somewhere. So that's like late 80s, early 90s. And then in high school, I was taking a bunch of computer classes as well as film studies courses. So I made a bunch of short films that were either a little avant-garde or usually horror-based. Did some things that you would get in big trouble for now, like bringing a fake gun to school to shoot a movie. Where, you know, and taking the fake gun, painting the tip black so that it didn't look like the orange fake gun.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
filming a whole thing in school, and this is after Columbine. Doing the whole thing and then having the video presented, I didn't know it was going to be done, but they presented it to the entire school as a short film festival. And when looking and seeing when the vice principal and the principal realized that I filmed it in the school, the look on their faces and the look of panic on my film teacher's face, because he didn't see the final cut before I edited it. And that would have been interesting. So I had that background. Luckily I got away with it because it was a very avant-garde sort of film. It was clearly not supposed to be like a school shooting video or anything. It was just, we had to film where we were filming. And I also took some computer programming courses, and everybody had to make Tetris for, I think it was when we were learning Pascal or Java or something. And I said, can I do something different? And they're like, okay, what do you want to do? So I ended up making my own RPG engine. So I made my own like simplistic JRPG engine, and I had a whole binder full of notes where I was going to make this sort of sci-fi fantasy world, a little bit of Final Fantasy, a little bit Star Wars sort of thing involved. I don't know where that is. I think I saved it. I transcoded it or transcribed it from a book onto a floppy disk, and Lord knows if I know where the floppy disk is and how to. I'd have to buy a external floppy drive controller just to like even check the few floppy disks I still have from back in the day. And if it's on there, cool. Then there's, you know, untapped stories. But that's pretty much where my background was with them. And other than, like, I had some friends that were cartoonists. And, you know, I'd help them conceptualize when they were making their own, like, publishing their own web strips and stuff back in the day. But that's about it.
All right. So now that we've kind of given everyone's kind of backgrounds from the creative arts, I guess we're going to kind of go around the table virtually to give our ideas. And we're going to start with me, then we're going to go to Steve, then we're going to go to Aaron, then we'll finally round things out with Alex. So I guess, do you guys want me to start with the shows I might resurrect or do that as kind of the end?
If we have honorable mentions or things you'd want to resurrect or remake, I think those should be first, just to get that out of the, you know, out of the way.
All right, cool then. So the ideas that I had for shows that could be resurrected or rebooted into a more current form is, during the 90s, there was a short-lived BattleTech animated series, which was not, it was a cool way to introduce kids to the BattleTech universe. For those of you that aren't necessarily familiar with BattleTech, imagine giant walking tanks, essentially from the 31st century, and it's basically a bunch of different houses fighting each other for control of a area of space known as the inner sphere, and the wars are decades or hundreds of years long, blood feuds lasting for generations, and it's a very warlike place, and technology is lost and gained and found again. It's a whole complicated history. So a series in the 90s was 13 episodes, explained a point in history known as the Clan Wars, where basically these guys came from deep outer space who originally were part of the inner sphere, said, you know what, your politics suck, we're leaving. And then they come back to conquer the inner sphere. And this unites everybody, comes together, and, you know, eventually we win at a cost. But my show would be a little bit different. I'd reboot it into live action, and my pitch would be, my elevator pitch would be Game of Thrones, but with mechs. So I'm going to set this during the Third Succession Wars, but before the Clan invasion. Each season would be about 13 episodes. And how this would work out is, this would lead up to the big bads of the series being the Clans in seasons 6 and 7. So establish all the houses, all the main characters, and kind of get to know the internal kind of politicking. Obviously, there will be some fights with mechs, but there'll be some land battles. But it's going to be about people first and foremost, to understand why these people are fighting. One of the things that I have set up in my show pitch is the Clan invasion is the show's equivalent to the Red Wedding from Game of Thrones. Basically, major characters die, a major world falls, and you realize things are very, very bad. And then you follow them to, I guess, some of the first major Clan offensives, and that's where the series goes from there. So that's about as far as I thought that out. The next one that I wanted to develop was Halo ODST. So this involves no Spartans. You will not see a Spartan until the last 5 minutes of the series. An ODST trooper is a orbital drop shock trooper. So basically a soldier wearing heavy armor. They come in these pods that are dropped from a spaceship from orbit. So I want this to feel like Band of Brothers, focused on fighting the aliens known as the Covenant. And I want this to happen before the Battle of Reach. Reach is a major turning point in the war where humanity is on the run. Bad things have happened. Most of the super soldiers are dead at this point. And I want it to be just very warlike, but I want it to have a little bit of heart too. And the series is going to end where you see the Master Chief get loaded onto the Pillar of Autumn at the end of Halo Reach. So you know where the series will end, but it's how you get there. So you follow this ODST team as they battle. And then
just to comment on that, wasn't that already what they were planning on making the TV show back in the day on?
I don't know if they ever developed that far. I know there was a short film that featured ODST people, but I don't know whether it was ever gone beyond that 5 to 10 minute pilot.
But this would be something I'd love to see. I just don't know if we ever will see it, because the Halo series has like been developed by Showtime for like a million years.
If Microsoft eventually they'll do something.
Yeah, if they are smart, the Master Chief still makes money. So the next series is animated that I'd love to do. And it has been shown that this series can survive in animation, but it's only ever had one movie. Mass Effect. I'm setting this post-first game. So you establish the world, you kind of know what's going on. Commander Shepard's established, but you will never meet Commander Shepard. Shepard is referenced. Shepard will also be canonically, in my world, FemShep, because FemShep is awesome. I love Jennifer Hale, and you can use her voice, because I think that'd be awesome. The series will follow a Salarian STG team or a Turian Spec Ops team, because I want to focus on the aliens, because Mass Effect, for the most part, does focus on the human alliance characters. Maybe we see the war from a different side. And with the freedom of animation, there's a lot of things you can do. Plus, setting it in this setting gives you the collector threat, gives you ideas if you want to follow the Reaper threat. Also allows a lot of the internal politicking with the Citadel races and whatnot. It gives you a lot of playground to go into if you want. Plus, if it's animated, like I said, there's no real budget limit, so you can do whatever you want. Maybe do a 26-episode season, see where it goes. Finally, before I get to my big pitch, Terminator. That's right, the series that never seems to friggin' die. We tried this before with Terminator, the Sarah Connor Chronicles, which ended on a cliffhanger that will never, ever get resolved. So, Reboot City. Let's go back to a time where this thing is set entirely during the Future War. In fact, takes place just after Judgment Day and follows a family trying to survive in the first days after the bombs have dropped. So this would follow the establishment of the Resistance and TechCom, and is essentially a road trip across America, starting in Boston and presumably ending up in like Wyoming or something.
It's like Walking Dead, but
yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. It's Walking Dead except with endoskeletons. Plus, they'd have to fight with other survivors, other monsters or things that are out there, because things might mutate. I'm not saying it's like Fallout, but hey, that's another series too, right? But yeah, and the idea is there's this thing known as the Skynet termination line. Everything behind that line dies. So my group of survivors, this family, which includes children, has to stay ahead of that line. Anything behind that line is dead. So it's always constant pressure to keep the series going. And obviously we would find out about the mythical John Connor. Would we ever meet him during the course of the series? I don't know. Maybe not, because you already know where the series is going to go, but I think it's getting there that is the most interesting. And that would be my pitch for a new Terminator series. Obviously, it's not going to be cheap because it's live action. But if you do, every series that's done Future War has always done just before Kyle Reese jumps back in time. We never see what happens immediately after the bombs fall. That chaos. So this would have more in line with Fear the Walking Dead than Walking Dead, which I think could be really, really, really fascinating.
So before you go into your main pitch, Mike, it's a lot to take in. Can we all comment on the previous shows?
Yes, please do.
Because you were on the fire. I made a note quickly on your first one, the mech one. It reminds me of a show.
BattleTech.
Yes, BattleTech. It reminds me of a show I used to watch as a kid that ran a couple seasons. It was called Exo Squad, I think. Mm-hmm. And that was a similar, because when you said Game of Thrones, that's what that was. It was like all these different factions and how they were dealing. It was a really advanced show for a kid's show, and it wasn't, as far as I could tell, like an anime. It wasn't an actual like American show. I don't know if it might have been, was it based on the same property? Maybe not, but it was
similar to the Super Sentai thing. It was like Superhuman Samurai Cyber Squad or something like that.
No,
Exo Squad.
There's an actual show called Exo Squad that's like a It's an animated mech show where they're
Are you thinking about Robotech?
Nope.
No, there is an Exo Squad. I vaguely remember this.
I'll end up throwing a
it's thing. Animated.
Yeah, it's a fully animated show. And I think it ran 26, 40
seasons. Maybe 2 seasons, maybe.
Something like that. Yeah.
2 seasons.
There was like I know I had a DVD of like the first season available, and the big deal with that show was for a cartoon, most of the episodes were 4 and 5 episode arcs. And it would be like they would just be to be continued for 4 or 5 episodes straight, telling one story each time. So that's what made me think of that, Mike, when you're saying Game of Thrones, like it's going to have multiple arcs. It could be done.
All the Beast Wars actors are in it.
One comment on yes. BattleTech.
Yes.
I'm sorry. Before I wanted to make sure I got in before we moved on to a different idea, one of your different ideas.
Yes.
I think there would be a BattleTech fan out there that's listening to that would have an eyebrow raised. I think instead of Third Succession War, you actually meant Fourth Succession War.
Oh yeah, sorry. Yeah. Sometimes okay. I get some
I'm just making sure because the Third Succession War is a pretty epic time where like the Innersphere is literally falling back into Mad Max kind of era, but the Fourth Succession War is the kind of grand big it's where Hans Davian starts the Fourth Succession War by giving away a rival house as a wedding gift to his new bride, and the actual leader of that house is sitting there in the audience going what the hell you know, you're giving my own realm away as a wedding gift, and they timed their invasion for that wedding gift. I mean, it's pretty crazy, but I thought that's the only thing I wanted to bring up. I'm sorry.
Oh no, that's fine.
Yeah, I think that's I linked it in the chat so you guys can check it out. But that show, it's a similar idea. It's not based on the same property, but that shows that it could be done. You know, they did it like 25 years ago, and you know, yeah. it didn't necessarily have the legs that it would probably have today. With you know, it was an unheard of concept. Other than I think some of the X-Men cartoon and Spider-Man had multi-part episodes, but as far as you know. They did it with an animated thing, so it shows that there's a market. They could do it live action, especially with, you know, if it was HBO or somebody.
Yeah, like my show needs a budget. We're talking HBO money for sure.
Yeah, because otherwise, if it showed up on the Sci-Fi network, it would just be cramped in a room with close-up shots of everybody, and then occasionally graphics that look worse than Babylon 5. So it has to be on Netflix, HBO. Or something to that extent. Like I Hulu wouldn't put up the money for it.
Yeah, exactly. Like this is a show I'd love to see done because the BattleTech property has such love behind it. It's not as well known as it used to be, but I think with the popularity of its games over the last couple of years, with like Parada Games and Paradox Interactive, there is love there still.
Because I don't know anything about, like, I'm not very familiar at all. Like, it's a different universe than MechWarrior, right?
No, it's the exact same thing, more or less.
Okay, so that's part of that, because that's my only experience then with it would be playing MechWarrior 2 and 3 back in the day.
Yeah. So that would be if I had to pick out of those 4 shows that I pitched, that would be the one I'd put the most money into. And then Terminator, probably. All right, so my next one that I mentioned was Halo. What do you guys have to say about that?
I think it's going to get done. It's just I don't know if it'll be the same timeline. I think it's going to depend. Like, they have been saying that they hadn't officially canceled that show that they were planning to do for the Xbox, you know, live thing, but then they canceled having Xbox Live do live video. So, but I wouldn't be surprised if they do something with Halo Infinite coming out with the new generation of systems. Like, but if they do it, Mike, I don't think they would put money into it. I think it would be something where they're like, hey, let's show off that we got this new tech. So let's pump $10 million and I'm making 10 minute shorts instead of making it like, you know, $10 to $20 million an episode sort of thing.
Yeah. Which is unfortunate because if you could get Disney Plus money into it, you could do it. And that's why I selected ODST troopers as opposed to like Spartans, because once you have these costumes, that's it. You don't have to customize them. They all look the same. They're basically like stormtrooper uniforms.
You could do like, it would cost a bit to get the costumes done, but like you said, once they're done, the advantage they would have is then Microsoft would have the actual uniforms and costumes that they could use for promotional materials for everything they do from then on.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Plus, it's still a loved universe. The franchise still does a lot of things. It's been, it's had two live action series that are very short. There was Nightfall and Forward Unto Dawn. And then there was Halo Legends, which was an animated series of shorts back in 2009. So the franchise still has legs. And as you mentioned, with the newest console generation coming up, that's got to mean something.
I could see them, as a final note for me, not doing it live action, Mike. I could see them using the game engine to...
That would be cool.
Because they're getting so photorealistic now that if they just said, hey, it's an animated series, but it's done in engine, using like whatever Unreal 5 or whatever the heck they're using, they could do that. And, you know, it would be very cheap because they have the engine built. And it would just be paying the programmers to script out the cutscenes. So instead of costing, you know, $10 million an episode, they can get that cost down to like $100,000 or whatever. Well, just paying the voice actors.
Yeah, and if you wanted to bring in more expensive voice talent, you could. Plus, I really want to have Keith. I want Keith David to star in this series just because I love his voice, because he was an amazing Spawn back in 1997. So, plus, he's Goliath. So, anyway. Mass Effect and Hell's Tale Space. Oh, yeah, and Mass Effect, yeah. Speaking of Mass Effect, that's my next series. What do you guys think?
I'm the weird one that, like, I guess I don't play a lot of video games. I mean, I've played the Mass Effect games and I like mm-hmm. them, but I don't think I can speak about them intelligently. Does that make sense?
Do you think a series set post first game would work to draw people in? Do you think you could get 26 episodes out of this?
I think that you can get a solid 10 episodes out of any decent idea as long as there's good writing and good acting. I'd say the Mass Effect universe has that potential. 26 episodes, you know, I don't know. It depends on how good the, you know, how well it's played off and, you know, the quality of the actors.
I think, Mike, you could get a 3-4 episode miniseries as a prequel, that leads up where humans make first contact. And then we have the Turian War, and you could end.
That's a good one.
And then the first part is humans discovering the Mass Effect relay in space. The second mm-hmm. is having the Turian War. And then the mm-hmm. third one is humans just being invited over to the Citadel. And you end it with Commander Shepard's flight to the Citadel to become a, you know, to sort of start out the game.
Okay.
And if you do it animated, I'm not talking not 20-minute episodes. You do, you know, 3 60-minute. You know, specials, and you could do that. So I guess if you're counting it as animated or as an episode count, you know, anywhere 8 to 10 20-minute episodes. Mm-hmm.
I think that the more interesting stories could take place on the Citadel, but the automatic comparison would be to Babylon 5, and I think that would be a disservice to both Babylon 5 and Mass Effect. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Mike, have you ever actually watched Babylon 5?
I've watched the first two seasons.
Because in playing Mass Effect, they took a lot from Babylon 5.
Yeah.
A lot. From a lot. Like, the main plot is basically Babylon 5.
And then I guess my final idea is the Terminator series. What do you guys think?
I love Terminator. I think that the Sarah Connor Chronicles was cut short far too soon. Just when it was really starting to get interesting. I think a show set directly after Judgment Day could be good, could be really good if done properly. I think that's the challenge. I think, well, the challenge is doing that properly in a post-nuclear kind of apocalypse, but also doing a Terminator well seems to be very difficult. I think it could be done really well. I'd love to see it. I want to see more good Terminator.
It would be interesting if they played it like the miniseries for Battlestar Galactica, where you just take most of the first season and have most of the first season happen beforehand. Make it like a family drama. And it's just, you're focusing on a family or a couple families, like one in Hawaii, one over here, one over there. And you're seeing them and they're living out their everyday lives like normal. And then at the end of the pilot or at the end of the first two episodes, the first bombs go off. and then you start to catch up and you become invested with these multiple families across the world and how it's affecting the world differently. And there's all the chaos that ensues. The people that are closest to it know what's going on, but the communication lines are down. You could do a really interesting thing with it, especially if you set it like, you know, let's say you set the show and you do it like 24, where each episode for the first, I don't know, seven episodes is, you know, a week before, you know, Judgment Day. And each day, like each episode starts with a countdown. And you,
oh, so, I like that.
So it builds attention. And you could even do it where in the top right corner of the screen, it literally has a timer counting down the minutes. And you, and then you get to the, you know, the last episode or the second last episode of the season, and you see each of the families as it ticks to zero. What happens? And then you set up, you see the bombs go off, and you, that's how you cut off the first season. And then you build up hype over 6 months to go into the second season, whether or not that'll give it time to see whether or not it has enough hype going into it if people really want to tune back in and watch. It also could leave it at a good point that if it got canceled, you're like, holy shit, we just saw what happened leading up to Judgment Day. And if it is popular, then you have multiple seasons you can go with, and you have already established characters.
You'd have to make sure that some of those families are tied into like Skynet and things like that. Fans actually want to keep knowing what happens to these people.
And it can start like,
rather than just random family drama, you know.
Well, no, yeah, sorry. What I meant was, I should have said that's actually where I was going with is, you know, you don't realize they're tied to it, but they are tied to it. So, you know, it'll be a family where it's like a truck driver and his family. Well, it turns out he works for Cyberdyne. And some of the stuff he's been transporting is, he's like, oh, I've got a government contract right now. We're transporting stuff back and forth. And you start to realize how they're connected. And I guess you could throw in a family, throw in the Dyson family or somebody that people would already know. So you have one person, you know, one person's family working at the center of it all. And then the rest of them are tangentially connected, or you find out, you know, it's like, oh, there's somebody that will play a big part in the future. You could even do something where the opening scenes of the show are either, you know, clips from the different movies that have been out showing the future, and you see some of these people, you know, when they're fully part of the resistance. And then it just like somebody gets, you know, knocked on their head or they're getting attacked, and they just flash back and it shows how everything began. That's when you have the countdown happening.
I like that.
Yeah.
That's clever. Okay, so now gather round, children. Sit tight and prepare you as I regale you with the tale of my main pitch. So this one is going to be something near and dear to my heart. I love horror movies. I love scary movies. And there are scary sci-fi movies. One of my favorite series of all times is Ripley Scott's Aliens. My favorite movie of all time is James Cameron's Alien. But I want to do something a little bit differently, because one of the things that horror movies have done to varying degrees of success is tackle H.P. Lovecraft's Cthulhu mythos, which we talked about in the last episode of Future Imperfect. So I am doing a mixture of William Gibson's genre that he more or less created, cyberpunk, and crossing that with Cthulhu. There was a role-playing game supplement years ago by Steve Jackson Games called Cthulhu Punk. I'm taking the basic idea and reworking it into my own thing. The title of my series is called Wetworked. The series is set in the year 2170 in Toronto. It follows the two private investigators known as Warren and Cassandra. Both are cybernetically augmented humans. Warren is a street-level operator who befriended Cass as an informant for the police once upon a time. So the story begins when a family approaches them to help solve a mystery involving their murdered daughter and their missing son. The first season follows the trail of a cult named the Yellow Faith and the Missing Son. A corporation named Citadel takes an interest in their investigation and occasionally helps them or hinders them as the course of the 10 to 13 episode series plays out. The antagonists for the first series include gang members, organ leggers, the cops, the cult of the Yellow Faith themselves. However, strange occurrences start to happen, and the Cthulhu mythos elements start to become apparent very early on when cult members rise from the dead and more, basically weird science, stuff like that. They may
Warren and Cass may pump them full of lead, they may get up from their wounds, and that's not possible, even in the cybernetic future. One of the important moments in the first season, in the first season involve a creature servitor known as a Baki tearing up a corporate security force. It's basically picture a flying insect that's giant with giant gnashing teeth and will rip you apart. A Migo mining operation. So in the H.P. Lovecraft universe, there are these weird looking creatures called the fungi from Yugoth. And they're warning Cass come across a mining operation and their human servitors, and something goes terribly, terribly wrong. And there's also an encounter with a creature known as a flying polyp who can generate winds so intense it blows the skin off your very bones. The season ends with a hooded figure emerging from the shadows, leading the missing son off to places unknown, and Warren and Cass are critically injured from a firefight from corporate security forces and two of those creatures. The reason I chose to end the series like this, or the season, is in H.P. Lovecraft stories, sometimes the best you can hope to do is break even. And sometimes it doesn't go your way. You are fighting against cosmic forces. And same with cyberpunk. It doesn't always go right. There's not always a happy ending. So if the series does get picked up for a season two, Warren and Cass survive. Maybe they become more human than human, so to speak, or more machine-like. We'll have to wait and see. Or maybe one of them dies. The people that I have cast in this series is Warren McGrath, and for that I've chosen one of my favorite actors of all time, Ice-T. I love his voice, I love his mannerisms, I love how he extrudes that exterior of cool confidence, and you don't want to fuck with this guy if you get into a straight up knuckle dust up with him. He will mess you up. I really like that about him. The person I chose as Cassandra Gibbons is the woman who played Judge Anderson from Dread back in 2012, and that's Olivia Thrilby. I just love her look. Again, just the way she moves. And I think she would play an interesting contrast to Ice-T as well. The supporting cast, I would cast as David. He plays the cult leader of the Yellow Faith. That is Brad Dourif. You may recognize him as the voice of Chucky. Again, has a certain presence when he's actually on screen. He was also famously Wormtongue from Lord of the Rings as well. And I kind of want that slimy, evil-looking dude where he looks very, very, very sickly but has the presence to command a room when he speaks. The voice of Hastur, who is the Mythos god in the series. I may have got this because I was watching a video on Splinter Cell, Michael Ironside, but he's also played the voice of Darkseid in many DC projects as well. So where we're going to kind of end things off here is this is my episode one plot synopsis. So the investigative team of Warren and Cass are introduced as a pair of private investigators who operate within Toronto, mostly dealing with runaways and insurance fraud. A murder of a local girl draws their attention when the family approaches them looking for answers and their missing son. The crime is largely ignored by the media and the police. The scene of the crime is of particular note because it took place within a mega corporation's main office at the Citadel Corporation. Corporate security is uncooperative and has little in the way of evidence they will actually share. Cass and Warren obtain security footage of the girl being murdered by something, and the missing son stands by while it happens. The pair decide to take the case when they see their inside source who provided them with the footage is murdered and know something larger is at hand. Citadel corporate security forces monitor Cass and Warren under the direction of a mysterious figure in yellow. The episode ends in an unknown location with strange chanting and something monstrous emerging from a circle drawn on the floor. And that's what I got for Wetwork, aka Cthulhu Punk.
Virgin Mobile's Sweet Pay is an affordable way to pay for a cool new phone so you can go from...
Just looking online.
To...
How much is this one?
To...
Ooh, I'll take this one.
Wait for it.
And I still get member benefits?
Yes, Sweet Pay gets you a hot new phone for $0 down. It's 0% APR and 24 low monthly payments on affordable two-year rate plans from $45 a month. Plus, get deals on fashion and entertainment with member benefits. Visit virginmobile.ca for details. Some extra charges apply. Virgin Mobile. It's better to be a member.
Thoughts, opinions?
I can start. I was just waiting
yeah, go for somebody else to go.
Oh, yeah. No, I like both Cthulhu. I like Cyberpunk. I think they can work very well together. I think that as long as you ground any of the special effects and the cybernetics and stuff like that that's happening in sort of a reality that is, you know, understandable slash, I don't know, Altered Carbon.
Yeah.
I think Altered Carbon. That there's cybernetics, there's weird special effects that happen with people and their, you know, implants and whatnot. But as long as you can understand it, and yeah, go with it. Cool. Because I think cybernetics can really get crazy.
Yeah, basically, I'm not going to have someone have like Cyberpunk 2020 with like a chain ripper in their arm or something ridiculous like that. Maybe the idea of wired reflexes, night vision, stuff like that. Maybe even implanted weaponry. I'm okay with that. But yeah, I don't want anything too ridiculous because that would just take you out of the scary element to the point where you can pump 30 rounds into that thing, and if it's not going to die, you can run as fast as you want. You're just going to die tired.
I mean, go with some body horror cybernetic kind of things, you know, like, hey, look, here's somebody's skull that can open up and you can look into their brain because they have, like, you know, memory slots in there. Some body horror stuff in a Cthulhu-esque setting is completely appropriate.
This would not be something that airs on broadcast TV. Well, maybe the CBC would do it, Mike, but I don't think it would air. Like, it wouldn't air. This is not something you could do on CBC, like CBS or NBC or something.
AMC might pick it up if I had to pick a network. AMC yeah, or HBO they, would be where I'd go.
Yeah, well, I think it's a given that all of us want our shows to be on HBO.
Yeah, budget. Big budget.
But it depends on who's producing it. Like, did you have an idea of who you'd like to produce it? Would it be, because this isn't something that would be like a Spielberg thing. Would you want them to pull in people from like different, would you want it to be like a cavalcade of directors from like the Masters of Horror series, those that are still alive or something?
Kind of, yeah. I want people who know how to do really good sci-fi, but I also want people who understand horror. I mean, I want people who understand the Cthulhu mythos a little bit better than most. And the guy who just did a story, or he just did a movie recently, we actually reviewed it on Twig about a month ago now, Color Out of Space, Richard Stanley. And not every episode has to have guns blazing and everything. Part of the Cthulhu mythos is the mind-bending insanity that you deal with. And as Cass and Warren investigate things.
So like, I don't know if he would do it based on his high profile projects right now, but like Denis Villeneuve, the Canadian director that did Enemy,
Blade Runner, wasn't it?
The new Blade Runner. He understands all that. But I was thinking, did you see the new trailer for the HBO the new Lovecraft TV show made by Jordan Peele?
Yes, I would love to get him involved.
So maybe Jordan Peele take control of it because he understands that weird horror thing. It's just you might need somebody that understands or does more with traditional like monster makeup involved too.
Yeah, like my series would be as many practical effects as possible, because as Aaron pointed out, if it's more grounded and it looks real, it's gonna get you more invested. And I'm not saying it has to go to Game of Thrones level of gore, but so you better believe what you're seeing.
What you'd want is for them to like have a pilot done by Cronenberg and then go from there.
Yes. Yes. Cronenberg,
yeah, body
with
horror.
A budget.
King of
yes.
Body.
Yeah, cool. I mean, I'd be game for that. Like, I and the advantage here is it wouldn't have to be over the top like jump scares. The best part of Lovecraftian stuff, especially and body horror, is the slow reveal, where it's like, oh, there's something in the corner, and it's slowly coming toward you, and you can't make out what it is.
Yeah, like
hey, that thing touched me. Now my arm hurts, and then you look and you see it pulsating and bubbling.
Yeah, because like that's why I only want to deal with certain monsters and mostly human servitors. That's why the flying creatures, I'm only dealing with those as big bads, like big moments. Like maybe the flying polyp could be like a mid-season episode because they're like, what the hell is that thing? But they're not going to run in the Shoggoths, which are basically sentient protoplasm, which eat people.
Yeah. You could do things like demonic trees and stuff like that could play into it, or play with the shadows more than anything, because then, you know, pretty cheap to do that.
Yeah, because I want it to be scary, but not like Buffy the Vampire Slayer Monster of the Week. Monsters are there, but you don't always see them. And sometimes you are the monster. Because part of cybernetics and body horror is you're taking a piece of yourself and changing it forever. That piece of meat and that piece of technology, even if it's genetic, if it's cybernetic, that comes at a price. So the more of you replace, the more of your humanity you eventually give up.
And you could even run it a little bit like Cronenberg's Existence, where people start implanting themselves with computerized components that allow them to interface with virtual reality games, and they stop being able to tell what's real and what's fake.
Yeah, like I'd love to do an episode featured around netrunners, people who plug their brains into a computer kind of virtually. So I have many cool ideas. So yeah, that would be wet worked. Steve, any comment from you, my friend?
Being that I'm unfamiliar with a lot of the things you just discussed, but it does sound interesting, the way that you've kind of weaved it together and made it sound with all the different variations of things going on, kind of making you think more internally with it too.
Yeah, because I don't want to just be like, ooh, look, blood and gore. That's cool and all, but I guess the ultimate question.
You want depth.
Yeah, I want depth to my series. And while there's going to be big monsters, and this is definitely a Cthulhu show, it's not going to be Cthulhu meets Buffy the Vampire Slayer. Like, because Ice-T can act, and there might be some kind of plot lines there about how he's questioned, man, I've given up a lot of my body over the years, how much of me is actually left. The other, the woman who's worked for the cops for years, maybe she asks herself, have I been on the right side of the law all this time? Maybe it's revealed over the course of the season she was former corporate security and she's been lying to Warren for years because it was part of her cover or something. I don't know. I'd make it up.
You know, like there actually was a show similar to this, not with the Cthulhu aspect, but the policing. And there came out, was it 3 or 4 years ago, 5 years ago, Almost Human? It was on Fox.
I think, yeah, it had
Carl Urban, yep.
Yeah, and it was, he gets an android partner, and then there's a whole bunch of mysterious techie stuff that starts happening.
I never did watch that show, but I always wanted to.
It was good, and then
it was,
I watched the first episode and went, Fox is going to cancel this. It's too good to be on Fox.
And it did.
All right. So I guess those are my ideas, such as they may be. So let's bring things up to the Admiral of the Future Imperfect, and that would be Steve Megatron Phillips. Thrill me, baby, with your honorable mentions, if you have any.
My honorable mentions, I came up with these while you were doing your honorable mentions. While I do enjoy some of the series and some of the thoughts that you had in some of those, I have a little bit different scenarios. Two of them are very similar. One of them is not. I do like the aspect of the Mech Warrior type of series. I did used to read those books. But I have Galaxy Quest as a TV series.
Interesting.
because it kind of takes the elements of what the Orville has that's good, except it's actors having to actually become this role that they played, but for real. Not just like the movie, but it's on an extended basis. The idea behind that is I not only one, enjoyed the series, but two, I like the entire premise of it because they're all basically green. So they would have to kind of figure it out as they go. So that's one of mine. Another one's Andromeda, just because I would like to see it with modern day special effects. And, it looks very dated compared to the Star Trek series that were even out around that time and previously, because it was made on Sci-Fi Channel.
Most things that the Sci-Fi Channel puts out now, anything they put out that wasn't dark matter in the last 10 years.
Yeah. But I would like to see, whether it be CBS or something, which is entirely possible because Roddenberry owns all of that stuff anyway, unless Sci-Fi has some kind of a vested interest in it. I would like to see CBS or somewhere else, or really anywhere that has the budget to actually put into it and remake it and kind of modernize it a little bit. I get that they would have some of the similar cast, you know, the Dylan Hunt character or the Andromeda and things like that. But I would like to see like a modern twist to it, much like how they've been kind of giving the shiny aspect to all of the modern Star Trek series, well, give or take what I like about them or not. But
why not HBO Max? Because they're not doing anything with Babylon 5 and they own the rights to that. But I believe, didn't Andromeda originally air on the WB in the States?
I think it was on UPN, right?
UPN.
I don't know if it was UPN.
I don't think it was WB.
It was probably WB, which was after UPN. Yeah. So, I would like to see that series come back because I do enjoy it, but it's sometimes hard to stomach just because it feels like a cheap 90s knockoff Star Trek in a lot of aspects, and because it's on Sci-Fi. And
I mean, they tried it a couple times. You know, they got a third or fourth time's charm, I guess. They tried it with John Saxon as a TV movie in the 70s. They tried doing it in the 80s again. I think it got called, like, I forget what they called it. There was two different movies that Warner Bros. Put out with it, and then they waited like 20 years and then made that. So my question to you is, since it was Hercules in space, are they going to cast The Rock, since he's the last person that played Hercules, as Dylan Hunt?
Hey, why not? You get a lot more fanfare to watch it.
Well, and I was thinking, he's also had his show Ballers on HBO for 5 years. He's got a relationship with them. So
that would be cool to see.
It would be interesting, like, if he's willing to do, like, I guess, a really super jacked up captain of a ship that can beat people. Then again, in that show, he was like that staff thing he would use to beat people up. And it wasn't as believable because Hercules wasn't as buff by the time he did that. That show, as he was, you know, 5 years earlier. So
yeah, he thinned out quite a bit. It would be nice to see this,
like, a full-blown, like, would you want it to be full-blown action or like the original one was, or a little more political? I think the action thing would be good as long as they make it
well, like, the thing is
extreme or anything.
Yeah, the thing is the way today's culture is, I could definitely see it fitting with the political aspect as well, just because the premise of the series was he kind of gets locked in a black hole and, you know, stuck there in time. And, you know, they find him hundreds of years later, and his entire world is, you know, not what he expects when he comes out the other side. So I could definitely see that taking place. Granted, the same concept is being stolen and used in Discovery season 3. So, because it's one ship thrown into the future and seeing the fallout of what happened.
There's only so many things you can do. It's just about creating an interesting bunch of characters. And if they did get somebody like The Rock on board, you know, it would get a straight to series order if he was interested.
Oh yeah, totally. And I would.
What was the last sci-fi movie The Rock did? Doom?
I think so. He's done a lot of world disaster films.
Yeah, like, he's done disaster movies or like He's done fantasy. Well, okay, here's a question. Do you count Jumanji? Where you get sucked
into a video game? I think that's more action fantasy.
Yeah, because you get sucked into a video game, I guess. I think he's working on something. But yeah, he hasn't done like a full-blown sci-fi movie.
Sci-fi since Doom.
Yeah. He's done like sci-fi-esque stuff, just nothing. Or wait, wasn't he in that movie that was pretty bad?
That's so specific.
Which one? Which one?
Oh, why am I drawing a blank on it?
Just IMDb him.
Yeah, I'll pull it up in a second here.
Skyscraper, Rampage.
I was happy for Skyscraper because he played an amputee, so go me. And Rampage was oddly charming.
It was better than it had any right to be, but they were smart to not market it as a video game movie.
Yeah.
San Andreas.
Even though you knew what it was.
I forgot about San Andreas. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
G.I. Joe doesn't count, does it?
Nah, that's just a really bad toy movie.
God, yeah. I see on IMDb, Big Trouble in Little China announced. Oh, yeah, no. Yeah, right.
He is paying to produce it himself.
Jack
Burton and the Meatball Express, baby.
That's a great movie.
I was right. It was Southland Tales. That's the movie that he did right after Doom. And he wasn't. And that was. Everybody forgets it because it was terrible, but that was a sci-fi movie. And he was supposed to do the Spy Hunter movie that never got made. But yeah, he hasn't really. Like, he played Hercules. He's done fantasy. It might be something to fill out his repertoire.
That's true.
Oh, good lord. He was in Gem and the Holograms.
Yeah, he was in. He was in Scorpion King way back when.
Yeah, fantasy.
Yeah, that had some awful special effects. I remember that.
That was a terrible movie. It made the mummy look good.
Yeah, it doesn't look like he's playing...
Doc Savage.
Yeah, he's
Black Adam. That one's been in pre-production for like 8 years.
Black Adam, that would be the closest, right, that he's going to be doing to pure...
Pretty much. I mean, it's superhero. It's still kind of a fantasy.
I think he could do it. He has the charisma to be a captain of a ship and do that whole thing. And if the whole idea is a leader of a ship is going to like reunite the universe, I'm sorry, Kevin Sorbo wasn't going to be that guy to give the right speeches. I could see the Rock getting people pumped enough to actually join him.
And then he would have the muscle to actually back it up while he's on his ship defending it by himself.
Yeah, at the beginning when there's that going on, because that had it had one of the best pilot episodes of its era.
Totally.
Where like you see it freeze, you see all the time stuff change around him, and then he gets pulled out of it, and he's like,
all right, everything falls apart.
He's like, basically, I got to contact the government. They're like, there's no government. First of all, what are you talking about? I've never even heard of what you're talking about. So that's what, like, as a kid, I was watching. I'm like, well, that would be scary. It's no longer that. Hey, oh, that's the old government that fell apart. It's been so long that nobody even knows what you're talking about. That like, there's no history of it at all. And he's like, oh, it's been a long time.
So he's done a sci-fi animated movie. Planet 51.
Okay. Yeah. So let's not talk about that.
No.
But yeah. So those are your honorable mentions, right? Or do you have any others?
I have one other one. It's Continuum.
I remember the name of the show, but I don't remember what
Yeah, it was four seasons, and it was a Canadian television show. And it has to do with like these. This rogue organization that causes havoc, and they're basically trying to put them down in the future, and they escape to the past and to like the year 2005 or something, and then they start influencing history. But what it doesn't tell you is like the guy that set it all in motion, he's a teenager in the past, and he basically set the whole thing in motion in the future. And then they have this one, like basically a time cop that goes back in time to round them up. And it's got a lot of weird sci-fi stuff in it, but it's a lot of time travel and a lot of like, it kind of grasps my attention just because it kind of plays with the paradoxes and the, predestination almost type things. But at the same time, it was still kind of forging its own different divergent history out of it.
It was one of my favorite shows when it aired. It was like 2012 to 2015.
It was one of my favorites as well.
And the evil, future version of the teenager that's like a good idealistic guy is the cancer smoking man, Mike.
William B. Davis. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's a who's who of Canadian actors in it that have been in sci-fi. A whole thing took place in BC, and the idea is she, like Steve said, she's got an implant in her head that lets her, because she's a cop from the future where they have, like, you know, they can view what you're seeing and all this. She goes back in time to the point where this kid is basically developing that network that, you know, is going to be a big player in the next 50, 60 years. So she like taps into it, and that's how they communicate. He's like, who the hell are you and what are you doing on my network? And she's like, who the hell are you and what are you doing in my police network? In her head. And that's where it's about stopping a terrorist group, but it's a cyclical thing. Like, you know, what came first? Did they have to send people in the past to do this, or you know, is it the future ruined because people were sent to the past? There's a lot of stuff that goes on. It was actually pretty high budget. It was run by, I think, Showcase up here. I have no idea who aired it in the States.
Sci-Fi.
Okay. And it was really, really well done, and it's worth a watch, Mike. It's only 42 episodes. Yeah, that's, I would have said a time travel one, but I figured somebody else was going to say that. And this is one where they did close the gap. So, like, it has a complete arc. But it
changed the history in the future.
Yeah, and it was quite clear that they got their episode orders cut short for the last two seasons. And I think the last season is like 6 or 8 episodes long.
Yeah, the last season was 6 episodes. They were supposed to have double that. And because it got canceled, they were only able to do those last episodes to wrap it up, and it felt very cut short.
Yeah, they were originally like, I think 10 or 13 per season, so it could have gone far, but they were at least smart enough to get a storyline out of the last episodes, and it didn't feel like it was as rushed as it could have been. And again, good actors, good storyline. We are due for a good time travel one. And this is, if anybody has seen or heard of Time Tracks, this was sort of a take on that. That was a show that aired on the P10 network, which became, I think, UPN eventually. It's the same network that showed Babylon 5, the first season. And Time Tracks is about a cop that went back in time to stop escape criminals and send them back. And it ran for 2 seasons. And this was, let's take that and make it a good show.
Yeah. Take these mediocre shows and make them a good show. So yeah, those were my honorable mentions. The storyline that I'd conjured up, I did it over the course of multiple, it took me about a year, like, overall to come up with this, because I like I said, I took the EDX classes, and the first one I developed one set of characters, hero and a villain. And it took place in a dystopian future with war ravaging everything, corporations owning everything, including the police. So basically, one by one, corporations would take over until they owned the police and their citizens. And there's an element of some basically rogue people that are battling against this big government entity that literally owns everything. Like, they call the shots. It's just, it's downright dirty. And there's this one character that survives this onslaught of this bombing on their location, and uses a time travel suit to go back in time to present day. And unbeknownst to the world, events take place back when he gets there. That will basically change the face of the planet until one particular man digs a little too closely to the details and discovers the head of the entire downfall of it. And he's basically sent to be assassinated during a conference where he's speaking about something, and he's doing a lot of humanitarian stuff. And they don't realize that they basically activated a mutant DNA code that causes him to heal. So he ends up not dead, but nobody knows it yet, because he's being secretly trained by this guy that came back from the future. So it's it's basically the rise of this character to basically almost a superhero-esque role, taking on the original prototype suit that eventually evolves into the one that the future person has. And so it's there's a lot of parallels with some of the things with Continuum, because I had watched that around the same time that I wrote this. And then there's other elements of Batman-esque type character villains involved in this. But what you basically end up with is I plotted out originally a 13-episode season where there would be different elements and different heroes that would come into the fold and different villains, some from another planet that kind of are what ends up escalating the future timeline. But yeah, that's kind of the premise. The show's called Altered Generations because there's a lot of time travel-y type stuff that goes back and forth, and that ends up altering history in different ways. But there's that's basically the start of the premise of what I had. I don't really have anybody cast in it per se, but I did like a lot of the production that was done on Continuum, and so like a lot of that I would probably take into consideration, as well as other known sci-fi people such as like a Brandon Braga or somebody like that to produce it. Thoughts?
I like the idea of the evolving suit becoming the more advanced one in the future. I think that's a really neat idea, actually.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. From a production standpoint, like how I was picturing it in my head was, like you said, the Continuum. Also, pretty underrated, I think, at least for the first couple seasons. That show on, was it TNT? Falling Skies? The look of that show.
Yeah.
It had a very grounded sort of feel and look, and I feel like that would be something interesting.
And that's kind of how this would kind of be, is that it would look like kind of a normal, modern, everyday life type of show. It would be live action, but it would also be modern in the sense that you would have a lot of the different a lot of different representations in it. There would be a lot of peaceful coexistence between people, at least until these corrupt people get involved. I also, the main character is basically, he owns a giant media organization, and so that's basically he's doing some news reporting, and he gets a little too close to the information, and that's why they hunt him down. But it ends up with an onslaught battle between him and the corporation leader, and you find out at the end of the first episode that he's not really the one pulling the cords on the entire situation. He's actually got a mad scientist that's in the basement of his building that you find out that this leader of this organization is actually a clone by the end of the first episode, leading to the fact that he's going to be back, just in a different...
Virgin Mobile Sweet Pay is an affordable way to pay for a cool new phone, so you can go from...
Just looking online.
To...
How much is this one?
To...
Ooh, I'll take this one.
Wait for it.
And I still get member benefits?
Yes. Sweet Pay gets you a hot new phone for $0 down. It's 0% APR and 24 low monthly payments on affordable two-year rate plans from $45 a month. Plus, get deals on fashion and entertainment with member benefits. Visit virginmobile.ca for details. Some extra charges apply. Virgin Mobile, it's better to be a member.
Virgin. Lot going on, I know, but
yeah,
makes sense in the screenplay.
I was going to say, it'd be something where when it's laid out in the sequence, it would make sense, because it's a lot to process.
Yes, and I've described it before. The first episode takes in a lot of that all in one, like in the first 60-minute screenplay. But yeah, so that's what I've got.
All right. So now that we have heard
of, it reminds me a little bit of Shadowrun as well. There's some
Shadowrun.
I like that. I like it.
So I guess if we don't have any more questions and comments for Steve, like I said, I think it's a neat idea. It's got that bit of a Shadowrun vibe to it. I dig it. So I guess moving on to our professional writer of the group, Aaron, what do you have for us?
You're putting all the pressure on me, professional. I have one pitch, and it's because I actually struggled for a while. I did not want to come up with like repitching a show that's already been out or reimagining one. I thought that was kind of me copping out in a way. I'm not trying to criticize anybody here at all, because I just wanted to try to do something fully original. And I struggled for a while because every idea that I did have that was fairly original, I didn't think I could easily pitch. It's more of like, hey, I should actually like write a novel about this, or maybe I should actually finish my novel instead of pitching it on the show. But I did come up with something, and I call it One Small Step. The concept is it's an alternate history show where the Apollo program of manned missions to the moon isn't canceled. Because of the politics in the United States, NASA continues to push outwards through the 1970s and 80s, capturing near-Earth asteroids for exploitation. The Soviets actually continue to do this as well. The Soviet Union never falls apart because of this, because in 1986, they capture a near-Earth asteroid that was highly rich in uranium and other precious metals, so their economy doesn't collapse like in our timeline. The current date for the show is actually in 2013, and NASA has pressed outwards into the solar system along with Sovcosmos, and it's basically the Greater Soviet Space Program, and tensions are high on Earth. Both programs have had colonies on Mars since the late 1990s, and each nation, along with some small groups from allied nations, have a sizable population there. When I'm saying sizable, I'm meaning like a couple hundred thousand people total. A few different conflicts have occurred differently than in our history, including a 2007 war in Iran and Pakistan, a brief but nuclear civil war in China, and an Argentinian empire slowly spreading through South America after a failed Falkland Islands war with the British, with the UK. The series, actually, the first episode, I only kind of envisioned six episodes for the first season, about an hour each. And the first episode is framed as a news channel documentary about the newest NASA Mars colony group. So this episode's kind of like the exposition episode, and it tells about the rise of the main space program and how it's different from our timeline, right? It'll give like a breakdown of the main personalities that are in this Mars colony group. It also gives an opportunity to talk about the challenges and the breakdown of the Outer Space Treaty of 1967. And I know that's really pedantic, but it's a real space treaty that was signed by most nations in 1967 that basically said, hey, let's not have wars in space, and nations can't actually use nuclear weapons in space. So the breakdown in the Outer Space Treaty actually occurred in 2001 between NATO forces and Warsaw Pact forces on Mars. And there were nuclear weapons used there, but obviously not everyone was killed. Anyway, I'm kind of going off topic here, but the series proper kicks off in season two with a strange discovery on the far side of the moon by an Indian minerals team. It's an alien device that turns on. And throughout the series, these devices, they're kind of like robots, begin turning on all over Earth, the moon, Mars. The different nations are able to capture some of them, and they clearly are fairly high tech. Most of them do not have weapons, but some do and fight back. The series overall shows that how these two power blocks are vying for these robotic creatures across all the worlds that people are on. But what the gist of these things are is that they've actually been on Earth for quite a long time, and every so often they wake up to observe humanity. And it just so happens that now is the time that they're awakening, and they finally see that humans have changed since the last time we saw them, and we're kind of scared about how quickly they changed and how quickly they spread out into the solar system. They need to contact their creators for new orders and hopefully to make first contact. But on the human side, much of this is the political intrigue that it's occurring on Mars, on Earth, as the military on both the big power blocks are trying to deal with the ramifications of alien robots waking up and kind of rampaging around, not really destroying things, but hey, look, there's a car. I'm going to go take it apart. And then, you know, the police have to come in and try to stop this thing if they can. And usually they can't. The governments on both sides are able to capture some of them, like I said, but being that both sides actually understand that the other side is capturing some of these things, both are worried about the other side gaining some sort of advantage from whatever they're capturing. And that's starting to ramp up tensions. The main characters are all basically on Mars, but there's lots of scenes that actually occur on Earth, like back in Moscow or at, you know, Houston, something like that. In the final episode, the robotic things on Mars actually take over a rocket and launch it at Phobos, and it turns out their big transceiver is there. But at this point, throughout the few episodes, we've seen the tensions ramping up on Earth from brush fire conflicts happening in some of these weird war zones that have occurred differently in our timeline, all the way to open conflict between the Warsaw Pact countries and NATO. There's one engagement that actually occurs on the moon between East and West German forces when they're trying to fight over what they discover as a big robot manufacturing facility. And they end up using nuclear weapons to fight each other, and they wipe themselves out and this factory. On Mars, when these robots take over the rocket to get off Mars and get to Phobos, which is where they have equipment to actually transmit to contact their creators, the Soviets actually at this point think that the NATO countries are launching a nuclear strike against them. And the Soviet general throughout this, who is a main character in the show, is actually a sympathetic character. He's not a villain. He actually has to try to take control against the political officers that are there trying to force the situation. And he ends up killing the political officer that's been trying to, I don't know, have this all end in bloodshed. Anyway, the missiles are about to go off on Earth, and Phobos kind of opens up into a big transmitter, a big flower-like device. And the last few moments on screen for the season is a voice that's heard deep in NORAD Cheyenne Mountain and under the Kremlin, and it says, "Hello, can you understand me?" And hopefully they are heard in time to stop the button from being pressed. So I have like two groups of main characters. One is the NASA characters, NASA/NATO characters, and then some characters from the Sov Cosmos Martian Occupation Force. On NATO, it's Colonel Amelia Cunningham, USAF, woman in a man's world, combat pilot that served during the Iran-Pakistani War of 2007. Spent the last 7 years studying for this mission to take command of a terraforming group that's going to Mars. Highly competent, has to rely on the advice of the science team and Dr. Herbert for these strange events. Dr. Gabriel Herbert is a late 50s male, seemingly an antagonist to Colonel Cunningham, but it's only because he doesn't like how the military has taken over many NASA programs since the Outer Space Treaty fell apart in 2001. Head of the Mars Colony Group 2013. And then I have like a third character that is Dr. Victor Panny, a French physicist. He's a sci-fi fan and becomes a de facto expert on things happening that are involved with these aliens. And it's just because he's the guy that's always been able to think outside the box. And then the two Soviet main characters are this general, Vasily Talonov. He's been a part of the Soviet space program since graduating college in Russia, married and divorced multiple times. Has one ex-wife on Mars with him, and he was the one who actually ordered the Soviet use of nukes on Mars in 2001. Not a villain, but has his own motivations for things, and thus can work against the point of view characters from NASA and still be a protagonist. And then there's the political officer, Colonel Anastasia Olivieva, KGB political officer from the Sov Cosmos program, clearly antagonist, works against General Talonov. Anytime he seems to stray at all from the exact wording of orders from Moscow and her like one line quote that define her character is the red planet will stay red. My six episodes are all named after things that are associated with the Apollo program. So episode one is One Small Step, and it's that documentary. Episode two is called Whoopee. It's actually a quote that from Apollo 12. Apollo 14 is episode three, and it's We're Here. Episode four is Man Must Explore. Episode five, Mysterious and Unknown. And episode six is Destiny of Tomorrow, which is one of the last things that was said on the moon during Apollo 17. But that's my general pitch. I know I said a lot there, and there's a lot of ideas that I kind of have written down in this. But questions, comments.
I am down for the politicking like you wouldn't believe. I love cerebral shows like this. Hell, you don't even need space aliens. I'm in it for the politicking. I just think it's neat how you've got like that. You had me hooked when you mentioned the South American angle. I'm thinking, ooh, nobody ever talks about that shit. That's cool.
You know what? To me, it sounds like it's an expansion of it, but have you, anybody else here seen For All Mankind yet? The Ronald D. Moore Apple TV show?
I have not.
Okay.
I'm so a space, but I just haven't seen it.
Okay. That show, it takes place, it starts in the 1960s and then jumps forward multiple years throughout the season. It is what would have happened if the Russians landed on the moon first and the space race never ended? And then you follow...
Yeah, this is definitely different than that, but yeah.
Yeah, I think that it's like, to me, it's like if you took that, added 2001 Space Odyssey, and then expanded the geopolitical aspect of it, which I like. It's like pulling from different things I love. So that Ron Moore show is good, but in watching it, I was like, okay, when are we going to get like real sci-fi stuff? Because it's trying to be as grounded as possible. So when shows like the 1970s or early 80s, they're like, we're on the moon now, and we have a colony, but it's like 20 people. And they're still relying on Earth for everything. But I like where you're going. I'm thinking of like that sort of a look, almost like, to me, it almost sounds like The West Wing, but in space.
Yeah, a little bit. I kind of think of it's more, when I thought of a couple shows that I could compare it to, it'd be kind of like The Expanse and West Wing, where there's some sort of weird alien threat, but it's still, the whole world is very grounded in more meteor regular subjects, where, you know.
So would it be like an Amazon Prime show then? Like, I'm trying, like, we're thinking like what networks could they be on?
Amazon Prime, I think, would be great. Netflix, I don't think it would work on, you know, cable TV.
Conventional TV. It would be something where it's like, Bezos or somebody high up at one of these companies would be like, I like that show, so I'm going to order 100 episodes of it. You'd be like, yes.
Yeah. And, you know, as I said, since it's kind of like, we're in 2020. This show takes place in 2013, but there's like weird things that are just different about their time, since technology has progressed differently, that things can still kind of futuristic and weird.
Well, and that's the idea, like even behind that Ron Moore show, it's you know, the idea of a military Cold War / space race never ending would have forced technology to be, you know, 50 years ahead of where we are now. If the, you know, technology, you know, moves forward for a few different reasons. A lot of times it's entertainment, or like pornography moving technology forward for whatever reason. But nothing moves technology forward like war or fear of war. So,
and this definitely would have had that with the Soviets capturing that near Earth asteroid. It's why their economy doesn't implode, is that they suddenly have this huge influx of raw materials to power their economy.
Yeah. So it wouldn't be anywhere out of the realm of being like, it's like, oh, that's science fiction. That's, it's 2013. Yeah, but it's 2013 if we had another 60 years of technology developed in a span of 10 years, sort of thing.
Yeah. And then like the world is still not well off, just because conflicts, these brush fire conflicts that happen between the U.S. and the Soviet Union, end up wrecking things even worse. I like the whole nuclear civil war in China, I kind of imagined was in the end what like the Soviets would have absorbed a big chunk of China that still remained communist, and then there would be kind of a division of China along north-south lines where there would be nationalist federalists in the south. And
in this vision, the UK never gave up Hong Kong.
They wouldn't have. Yeah. They would have said we have to protect our interests there and trying to save face from losing the Falklands conflict. Then you'd have the rest of NATO being involved. There's a lot of geopolitics going on while there's aliens too, but it's exploring this world where just things are not a lot different, but definitely different. They've taken a strange turn.
You need that Amazon money like now. I'm just saying, this would be fucking so cool. My God.
What you could do with not an hugely expensive effects budget, because you could be sparing with when you choose to show certain shots. A lot of it can be told, just by the people themselves. So I could see how they could do it on the cheap without looking cheap.
Yeah. And the whole first episode is shot documentary, like PBS or, PBS style.
Get Ken Burns to do your first episode, just in picture form.
Yeah, exactly. Something like that. And, I don't want actors that are well known for the main characters. I could totally see somebody that is either well known, not just as an actor, but as
just don't get Will Smith or somebody.
I'm saying, hey, you want Neil deGrasse Tyson to appear as Neil deGrasse Tyson? Go ahead.
He's a communist or something. it would be interesting because, division lines would be different from a lot of famous scientists that,
never would have defected, maybe.
Well, there are a lot of scientists that are either famous now or engineers that came out of, the former Soviet Union would never have come here. So there would be a lot of tech that we don't have that they would have.
Yeah. And I had thought about that. I had thought about, I didn't want to mention who's president when, just the fact that Nixon didn't cancel the Apollo program and why he didn't might be a plot point in the first episode when doing this documentary. Maybe he thought that losing the Vietnam War was a bad idea, so he needed a public relations coup and decided to just throw everything at the space program.
What you're saying, that's exactly what happens.
Really, it is. I'm not original. I apologize.
No. I'm saying they're great ideas that we had never seen before, and it would be worth checking out that show because they're in the show you hear people talking about the different presidents that have come through, and when things aren't going well in Vietnam, then that's when Nixon decides to invest a lot of money into it to show we can't let these commie bastards, it basically says, we can't let these commie bastards show us up on everything. They're on the moon first. Vietnam's not going the way it needs to go. You need to, make some progress on your colony on the moon. You have to, and it costs $10 billion. Okay, we'll do it. We don't care because we have to have a win.
Yeah. And mine's more of a break point. That's after the moon landings, that the U.S. still lands on the moon first. The initial Apollo program missions go through Apollo 17. And then, the missions are continued past that. There's Apollo 18 through 26 in my notes, and then it turns into a different kind of system where the shuttles are developed and used, but something else is used to get back to the moon. And that's where the Soviets start doing stuff like capturing the near Earth asteroids, where the shuttles are building a U.S. station in orbit to transfer stuff to the moon better. I don't know. Lots of notes, but
okay. Any other further comment from our committee, sir? I feel like I'm taking council notes.
Okay. So I guess now that we have Aaron's, frankly, sci-fi epic out of the way, we're going to finish things off going into Alex. What do you got for us?
I have to follow that.
Yep. Good luck.
Okay. So mine are more of the old school, like one line pitches, and I can sort of elaborate. And I thought you guys might want to like put your own inputs in it. That's why I didn't want to flesh it out too much. But my two very quickly, my, I guess, reboots or remakes I'd like to see is, I've talked about it before with you guys. I really liked that show that only ran for like 7 episodes called Mercy Point, which was, think Space Station Hospital show. I like the idea of taking a sci-fi or taking a regular everyday show and then just making it a sci-fi show. So, you know, and it can be, in this case, it's a hospital show where you're dealing with different anatomy, and it's like a medical hospital slash school. I like that idea. It's sort of like what could have been with if they had done like a Starfleet Academy show, but this is just a medical show. So I thought that was neat because it just came out at the weird time. It was on UPN, ran like 6 episodes, got canceled before I think the 7th or 8th aired. Been forgotten to time, but you know, it's a neat idea. It's something different than what's been out there lately. And the other that I think could use a complete full remake is The Star Lost. I don't know if anybody else has seen that.
Never heard of it, no.
Harlan Ellison made the show after being adversarial with the Star Trek people back in the day. It was a Canadian show on CTV, I think. Was it CBS or somebody was supposed to work with them on it? And then they pulled out at the last minute, so the budget got slashed to like a tenth of what it was going to be. It was being touted back in the day as the next Star Trek. Not by the Star Trek people, but as the next new thing. The full idea for the show eventually was turned into, I think, a comic book graphic novel series from IDW. Harlan Ellison put it out like years and years later. But the basic idea for the show is it starts out in this Amish community, Amish Mennonite community, and a little bit like The Village, where it's like you're not allowed to leave, you know, the township. You have to stay within this border, and you know, it starts out for the first episode being basically like Little House on the Prairie. But at the end of the episode, one of the main character ventures beyond a certain point and ends up finding like a door. When he opens the door, it goes from being this like Amish paradise community to being clearly on a spaceship. And he finds out, a few people get exiled for finding out the truth that, you know, you went beyond where you're supposed to go and you're banished. So he has to leave with a couple friends, and they end up coming towards a control thing. They obviously have no idea what technology is. They can, you know, they can't even really read because they're only, you know, they can read what's in like the Bible, what they're given, but they have to try to decipher computer screens and terminals. And they eventually turn on I guess the computer, which is like, it was supposed to be like a hologram, but it was clearly just a TV screen in the show where a guy's talking through it, explaining that, you know, you're on basically an Earthship arc that was launched hundreds and hundreds of years ago because the planet was no longer viable. So they grabbed every community possible and put them in these, you know, domed pods within the giant arc. Like, we're talking something beyond massive as far as something. This was their pod was the size of a town, or, you know, with like full farmlands and everything around them. But the computer says, you know, there's significant danger. We're veering off course. And in the show, they're like, if we don't correct the course, we're eventually going to be going into the path of a star. Something happened. The computer doesn't know. And in the show, I think it only ran 14 episodes. But in the show, they're like, okay, they're like, so inform the crew, this, and they're like, crew, what crew? There's no humans. There's nobody. It's like the ship's been empty. But each episode is them trying to find anybody that can help correct the ship, fix the errors. Like, there's decompressed areas. There's malfunctioning areas with, you know, automated things that aren't working. And each episode, they went to a different dome, and it would be dealing with a different community. So some would be like they were from one that was supposed to preserve like the Amish or Mennonite way of life, and they find one where it's like just, you know, it felt like regular 1970s people, because the show came out in the 70s, and the idea is every one of these cultures, the trip took so much longer than it was supposed to take, that it's now become a multi-generational ship, and people don't even remember what Earth was. So they're going from different pods trying to, you know, get people to help them, or they even find at one point in the show sleeping chambers, like cryogenic chambers for some of the crew. And a couple of the crew members revive, and they say, you know, we want to help. But then they realize they forgot why they were frozen. They have a degenerative disease. And the people in the regular, you know, the regular pods, they're fine. It's just these people were exposed to something. And then there's aliens that come involved. And I think Chekhov from the original Star Trek is in it too, as an evil alien. but the whole idea is that it's like an arc show. It hasn't been done like this before. We've had like Voyager, Star Trek Voyager. We've had ones like this, but we haven't done this premise since the show came out in the 70s. Brilliant idea, shoestring budget. Like we're talking like Doctor Who levels of budget back then. Well, actually, it was probably better looking than Doctor Who. It was put out on DVD years ago. It's worth watching, and it's a show that Harlan Ellison had planned out multiple seasons for, and it got canceled after one because. Especially back in the 70s, CTV could not fund a sci-fi show for that long. They basically ran out of money.
So God, those are my this show sounds fucking cool.
Those are my honorable mentions. I'll show you guys a trailer for it. They're like, they did a whole, oh, and the main character for the show, the original version, is the dude from 2001 Space Odyssey. Kier Dulia, I think is his name. So they did a whole pitching the show and how it was going to be this big, massive production, building these big sets and all this, and their budget was slashed to like literally 10% of what it was because the American company pulled out. Mm. And then Harlan Ellison was, you know, being grumpy and didn't want to pitch it to anybody else. So those are my honorable mentions. And then as far as my pitches for the, I have three of them, and they're very simple sort of premises. The idea is, almost like a creative writing experiment. It's like, what is a basic show premise that I would like to see done? And then you can work from it from there. So the first idea I had was a show about a sort of an interplanetary war, but it's from the perspective of, you know, regular people in a town. But the idea is that the government has known about aliens for, you know, years and years. And the whole Roswell incident was actually an alien coming to Earth to warn us that, you know, a galaxy-spanning war was, the front line was moving towards our galaxy. And they found us to be the only intelligent life in the Milky Way. And they're like, they knew that we weren't ready for it. They didn't want, you know, us to, you know, face our fate, you know, alone without a fighting chance. So what they brought us before dying was plans to build planetary defense systems. So for the last 60 years, what the world's been doing is secretly they're doing all these construction. Like whenever you see construction, people always like, why does the highway have endless construction? Why does my town have endless construction? But the reality is it's all these elaborate plans to people building little segments here and there. And what they're actually building is like ion cannons and defense grids that will eventually activate like an auto turret or auto defense when the war finally comes to get us. The aliens knew that, you know, we weren't going to be able to build, you know, massive ships to basically vacate the Earth because that would be chaotic. The idea was give us a defense. So the show takes place where everything is pretty normal. Everything's happening like everyday life. And then, you know, there's a news article showing that, you know, aliens exist. We can see there's something flying towards us, and the governments have to do, like, they do a full, like, every channel's taken over by your respective governments. They come out and talk about, yes, this is something that we've known about, but we knew would cause a panic. We couldn't until we were ready. Don't be alarmed. We're activating our you know, defense mechanisms now. They press a button, and almost like a dome or like a shield of ionic energy covers the planet so that nothing can attack us, nothing can land. It means we can't leave until this ends, but that we're safe. And then the show gets into the political aspects of, you know, who knew about this? Why? What are we doing? What, you know, what's going to happen? The whole season is a looming dread of, you know, this intergalactic, you know, war that we can't even fathom how large it is, with the front line coming towards us. And then it ends the first season with people looking up, they're feeling rumbles. They look up and they just see a bombardment of weaponry firing at the planet that's being protected by the shield. And then it goes to be continued for the next season.
So I like the idea.
That's the first one. Again, it's just a jumping point. You can alter things in, here and there for it, but I just like the idea of, you know, basically I wanted an explanation for why is there always construction? And that's why. Is that, you know, it's we're doing road work. Why does the road work take like 3 years? And it doesn't seem like anybody's doing anything. Well, it's because they're actually laying the groundwork for this alien tech. And it looks mundane to us. It's like, oh, we're laying fiber optic cabling for this. It's not really fiber optic cabling. That sort of idea. The second premise, the short one that I have here was, think it's basically Star Trek, but flip it around. The show follows a research ship similar to the main mission of the Enterprise, but it's all aliens. There's no humans in the main cast whatsoever, which, you know, people said for years can't be done because how are you going to relate to them? Well, you relate to characters based on their personalities and who they are. I always thought it was stupid that we had to have human characters on the cast. But the idea is they're from a distant part of the galaxy, and you get introduced to all these different characters, their backgrounds, and you can have, you know, insert your alien type here. Everything ranging from like the types of aliens of Mass Effect to Star Trek and so on. You know how they can all have somewhat relatable things to Earth, like, as far as their personalities, like how one's supposed to be representative of this type of people, that sort of thing. Anyway, take that out of the fact, you can write that in later. But while they're doing their regular mission in the first episode, what they come across is the Voyager Golden Record. You know, it's somehow made, like, this is, we don't know what year this is. It's not explained. You slowly reveal what's happening, but they come across, you know, the message we sent in space. Who knows how long ago it was sent, and who knows how far away this is. They discover it, and it's them. It becomes a big hubbub that they're, you know, a group of aliens from a galaxy, and they think, like, well, something, clearly they're smart enough to know something's tried to make contact with us. And the season is about trying to get mount an actual mission to find, you know, these aliens, which are us, and make contact with us. So the goal is basically first contact from an alien's perspective. And the real mystery is going to be when they come and find Earth, you know, what year is it going to be? Are we there? Have we wiped ourselves out? Are we no longer there? Or is it like present day? You know, like is it near future? Is it far future? And it will sort of lead up to it. But the entire trip as they're getting out towards Earth, it's going to play out similar to your Star Trek with your moral quandaries and your science fiction escapades. All with the B thread of being, we're finding this planet that, you know, they don't necessarily know to call it Earth, but they've got, you know, in the ship, they've got the Golden Record, and, you know, they're looking at it, and to them it looks so alien and strange. So that's that was the second premise I had there.
The end credits could be a song from the Golden Record, a different song.
Totally. I just thought it was like, as a kid, that was when I always thought of it. Like, well, we sent that out into space, and it's like, well, what if somebody found it? You know, you could make a show, you could make a story of what it would be like for first contact, but from their perspective. And you can, you know, do that with what you will when it comes to, you know, how they would view humanity, or, you know, would they, you know, the question would be, would they view humanity come to us and see us all as one species, or would they come to us and just like assume that, you know, dolphins are the smartest, you know, creatures. You know, there could be different aspects, right, based on what we perceive intelligence to be. So, like, what if they came to Earth and they talk to us for a minute, but like, no, we're going to talk to, you know, the people that really do things here. And they're like, we're like, what? And, you know, they take their ship and take it underwater. And we're like, why are you going underwater? You know, there could be different things to do there, but I thought that was kind of neat. And the third idea I had, I actually had it when I had a weird dream about a year ago, maybe 6 months, year. And this one is the one that's a little more out of the box. It's again another one where it's like there's an alien war going on. All in this one, all of the men and women that are, you know, healthy and a fighting age have gone off to fight in an interstellar war way far away with an alien that we barely know. We don't necessarily even know what's going on with them. It's so distant, but we've been called off. And what we're left with is the show actually takes place with the children that are left behind and the elderly. And they're basically put in charge of planetary defenses while living their regular lives. So whenever, let's say, equivalent of like a long-range meteor or mortar shell or a scout ship, you know, a drone comes by, they have to shoot it down. But the main show is not really about the aliens whatsoever. There are parts of every episode where they have to defend it and do the, you know, shoot them down, but it's actually these old ladies that the show focuses on these old ladies that I dubbed the gun grannies, and their job is to basically man the turrets that knock them down and defend everything, all the while they're helping raise the kids, tell them stories of their backgrounds, you know they're from Europe or somewhere else, telling them life lessons. And every single episode, like this is where it's a twist. The show I'm pitching would be on the Cooking Network. Every single episode, one of the grannies teaches the kids how to cook something, and you know, a family heirloom dish, some sort of delicacy from their home, whatever country they're from. And yes, you have the drama. There's storylines going on where there's something going on with this interstellar war, and they have to man the battle stations, and there can be, you know, drama between the kids and all this. But in every single episode, somebody, you know, they end up cooking and showing a new recipe. So it's actually an educational show as well as a drama. And I just thought, like, it would be something where it's like, what if the Cooking Channel did a drama, and, you know, and they just happen to get away with it. And it could even go on like PBS, because it's like there's educational aspects to it where or even on the History Channel, where they're telling history, true history of certain people from whatever European country, Africa, South America. But every single episode, a different dish is cooked with the kids. And the whole idea is about promoting family and all this. All the while, it's an interstellar war. So that's my weird pitch for Gun Grannies. And I thought about it more as a graphic novel and cartoon initially. And then I thought, well, what about if we do make it a cooking show? Because has there ever been a sci-fi cooking show? No. So I feel that's my very Alex pitch.
Okay. I like your idea of them building up the defenses, because it actually ties into a conspiracy with the Denver airport as to why is it so, it doesn't make any sense why it's so huge. And there's been rumors about there's like a secret hangar under it and all this shit. And as you mentioned, there's always construction somewhere, and all the budgets people can't explain and all this crap. So
that was one thing I forgot to mention with that, was people are always asking, why is the highway infrastructure so shit? Why they spend so much money on the Department of Defense, and they spend so much money on this. Why are our roads and infrastructure falling apart? The idea is they're funneling all of the money into these underground defense systems.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a pretty solid idea. I like your second idea the most, though, about the idea of the aliens looking for Earth. We don't have any idea how long it's been. And I like the idea of them coming to... Actually, hell, I'd end the series, them coming to Earth, and the first person they meet's a child, and you don't know what year it is. But like, they come to Earth, and they meet a kid.
And the kid, like, if you wanted to make it smart so that you couldn't tell what year it is, the kid's just wearing swimming trunks, they're at the beach.
Yep, and the kid just looks up and says, hi. And the aliens are like, hi?
Especially if you make it a really young child that wouldn't necessarily panic or freak out, like a toddler.
Exactly.
Hello.
Yeah, I mean, I think that would be such a smart way to end a series. Like, yes, they found us, but what happens next is up to you. Yeah, that'd be really, really fantastic. And Aaron's idea, where each episode ends with a track from the Golden Record, each episode could start with a greeting from the Golden Record, which gives you a finite number of episodes to get to where you need to be.
And you then the last somebody on the ship that becomes obsessed with, you know, the humans, but whatever, and maybe they don't even call us humans because they don't decipher language right away, but they become obsessed with us. And then you have others that are like, they don't really exist, or they, you know, not that they're denying our existence, but they're like, they're probably all dead, that sort of thing. Like, how could something get this far away? They look at the star pattern, like, they're like, oh, this journey with our speed of travel is going to take us 6 years to get there with our technology. The technology that they could tell that was launched with, it shouldn't have been able to get here. So part of the question becomes, how did the Voyager disc get there as well?
If you meet a child at the end of the last episode could just end with that quote from the Golden Record that says, "Hello from the children of planet Earth."
Yes. Yes. That'd be so sick. My God, man, this would be a serious pitch. This would be a wonderful miniseries.
That was one that I had thought about doing for quite some time. Like, even in high school, I was pitching around ideas in my head. Gun Grannies, I just thought was funny, because I was like, hey, let's do a cooking show where a bunch of, you know, old European grannies teach us how to cook, also while shooting down alien debris. It would make for a better comic book than a series, but I could see it being, I think, like Dinner in a Movie, only the dinner is the movie.
I really liked the show that you mentioned about that guy Starloth. That sounds cool.
Yeah, like, I've got that. I'll let you borrow it so you can take a look. It's really it's worth it, because you can tolerate Doctor Who from like the pre-2000s show, right?
Like, I love 1970s Doctor Who. My God.
Okay, this is higher budget than that, but it was low budget when compared to... Well, actually, there wasn't a whole... It's low budget when compared to Space 1999, but that was also a stupid high budget for the time.
Okay. But yeah, I mean, like, I think there's potential there. I mean, honestly, I think that show could get rebooted so easy. Hell, you could even put that Starloth show on Sci-Fi Network, and it really wouldn't need that much of a budget. You just need a few futuristic sets.
I'm checking. And you could shift it around. Tried to years ago. Let me double check.
Yeah, like, that's got some really neat ideas. I mean, I don't know, like, from short prompts, you've got some really cool ideas. Gun Greenies, I think, would work as a trade paperback or like a series of comic books. And at the end of each comic book, and I saw this with the Pathfinder series of comics, each book tells a story, but the end of each Pathfinder comic book, you got role-playing stats, you got a map, and you got a poster. If you did Gun Grannies as a comic book, you get the story, and at the end, you get a recipe card.
Yeah, that would be cool. And that was where it came into it, too. I was like, you could do it as, you know, a cartoon, you could do it as a live action. But yeah, as a comic book, and then, yeah, at the very end, you could even have it sponsored by, like, a food company or something. Or you could have it sponsored by, I don't know, the Canada Food Guide or something, or whatever the equivalent to the American one is. And the whole idea is, I like the idea of a sci-fi show that has some, you know, elements that adults would like to get interested in. It's like, oh, there's a lore behind that. What's going on with that interstellar war? Well, we're never going to get to that because we're dealing with these people here. And you could do extended fiction about what happens there. But the idea is, it's about the old teaching the young, you know, values. At the same time, you get to learn something about cooking. Like, maybe it's like, you know... Grandma, your Nona Ricci's spaghetti and meatballs recipe, and it's stuff that kids can learn and do themselves. But it no longer becomes like, I don't want to cook, or I don't want to just. It becomes cool because, hey, it's from a comic book about aliens, and the Gun Granny's teaching me how to make these. And then it's like somebody else comes in and it's like, and here's how we make, you know, cabbage rolls, and from whatever background you're from. And so you could do it where, like, once if the comic book came out once a month, it would be the equivalent. You could tell a whole story in, you know, a 12 episode story in the course of a year, and then you'd have by the end of it a cookbook. And by the time a kid has like been reading for a couple of years, they'd have a whole repertoire of basic but delicious and nutritious meals they can make themselves. All under the guise of not realizing they were being taught things necessarily when it's like, you know, geared towards 7-8 year old kids.
I'm not even kidding, Alex. You should seriously consider developing this idea a little bit further. It sounded stupid at first, but it sounds really neat, actually.
It's the one that I had been mulling around for, you know, I had a weird dream where that came into my head last August, I think. And that might be one that I could pitch, because it's one that I could see, getting some government money for. Because yeah, if there's an educational or a historical background, especially if you incorporate some things like, if you incorporate like one of the grannies teaching Canadian history or different things, like you could, I feel like too many shows that are educational for kids are just purely educational or dumbed down or made where kids think they're lame. And this would be a show that doesn't do the whole like, here, you should be learning this. It's just during the course of, or even the issue or the an episode, during the course of it, you happen to learn things along the way, but the whole narrative is not about, you know, pushing things down your throat sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think it's a really neat idea. I think it's got legs, at least as something anyway. So
I told you guys, this, my ideas were going to be a little different.
They most certainly are. I guess before we begin to close out the show, there were some other ideas that I just thought about. I mentioned before the show, but I didn't want to develop them. There were a couple of other movies I thought about developing in the shows, but I thought probably not. Although I did think of one. I did think to bring up, it was a TV show, but it lasted less than 6 episodes, and it was on ABC. Time Cop. Just since you were talking about that time track show.
Yeah, that came out around the same time, because we were talking before about like the tech war and all that. It came around the same time as that. And like, wasn't there a version of the net that came out at the same time?
Yep, there was. So yeah, that'd be a show I would like.
The Time Cop show, I don't think that one's ever had a DVD release, whereas all the other ones
have. No, it never has. I mean, I'm sure if you went to some like tape trading forum, you could find it, but I've never seen an episode. Actually, I don't know, maybe I should look on YouTube. Maybe somebody's put up an episode, but that'd be cool. So I guess I don't know if there's anything else we could all add to each other. I think all of us had fantastic ideas.
I was gonna say the other guys didn't really chime in on mine because I know they were weird.
Yeah, guys, feedback.
Well, funny thing is I could see it becoming a series just because it's something so polarizingly different that it would stand out. The other thing is you should try pitching it to Amazon, because they actually have a place where you can do that publicly.
Oh, well, yeah, that's true. Really? That's right.
Because I've tried pitching my script there before, but it was like years ago, and I found things in it that I was like, if I fix these couple of things, I think it could make it. But I never got to that point. So
I think what I would do is I would probably write the first episode of, if I was doing the Gun Grannies one, I would write the first episode and then have that thing turned into a comic book, you know, pay a friend or an artist to make some to make it, and that would be the pitch. It's like, here, it's in the comic book. Mm-hmm. This is the idea for the show, and you pitch that to people.
Well, because then they get the visual with it, and then you can have like an entire like story guide for it.
And then I was laughing at myself and thinking, I could have action figures of all the old grannies, and the whole idea is, it's like picture your grandmother with a space army helmet on, shooting a turret, and then going over and going, oh no, I have to go stir the sauce. And then having the kids stir the sauce with them and then telling them stories.
I kind of pictured the Golden Girls manning the Death Star turrets from the first movie, and them making spaghetti and meatballs. That's what I pictured in my head.
It was, even though it's like, you know, turrets on the ground, it's literally Golden Girls in that scene from Star Wars where they're in the Millennium Falcon shooting things down. think the same getup with what they're wearing. They're tilting it around, they're shooting, and then when they're done, they have to go teach because all the adults have been sent off to war. They have to go teach school, and they learn like whatever lesson, and then they're like, and by the way, it's time for lunch. We're going to prep it, and then they'll tell a story about their past or you know, life lessons, whatever your standard drama is, while they're chopping the food, preparing it with the kids, measuring it out, having the kids do it with them, so that it sort of builds, showing that making a meal can be like a family affair.
You could even name each episode after a food, and that would make it more creative. Like maybe cabbage rolls is about fighter pilots. Spaghetti and meatballs is maybe going into the trenches. You could call it Granny's Thick Chili is about a particularly muddy ground war or something. Yeah, yeah, like, well, you've got potential in this. I'm not
the idea, like the story that is tied in, like they'll tell a life lesson or a story, and it's tied into something that's happening in the episode. Like say they're under attack or something, they'll be like, this reminds me of this, and they'll tell a story from their past or something that's historically relevant and tie a food in with it, like you said. So it could be done. Now I actually do have to write that down and make it a full-fledged thing, because I mean, whether it goes somewhere or not, I just think it's a neat idea that nobody's really done before, like sci-fi and cooking show / educational show that isn't lame.
So I guess any other thoughts on all these things out of Alex? Going once?
Not I.
Not I. All right, then. All right, so I guess we've pretty much run this train as far as we possibly can. Obviously, we have explored different creative ideas from each of our backgrounds, from superheroes to Cthulhu to the far reaches of space, and finally, grannies who cook and man turrets. We've certainly run the gamut of unique ideas, and it's been a fascinating experience. Definitely a really interesting conversation, but as always, we do want to hear from you. So, Steve, if they want to get a hold of the program, how would they go about doing so?
Feedback at geekcastradio.com or feedback at thisweekingeek.net.
Of course, guys, we do look forward to hearing from you, and we'd love to hear some of your pitches. If you have like a really cool idea, give us your elevator pitch. An elevator pitch is if you can explain it to me in about 30 seconds to 1 minute, go ahead. We will read it on the air, critique, and give you our feedback on your really cool ideas. We do look forward to hearing from you. So for Future Imperfect, we have been
Steve Megatron Phillips.
I'm Aaron Pollyea.
And Alex, I guess we're going by that order again, eh?
Yep, we are going to stick with that from now on. And until next time, I've been Mike the Birdman Dodd saying live long and prosper.
Virgin Mobile's Sweet Pay is an affordable way to pay for a cool new phone so you can go from
just looking online
to
how much is this one?
To
ooh, I'll take this one.
Wait for it.
And I still get member benefits?
Yes, Sweet Pay gets you a hot new phone for $0 down. It's 0% APR and 24 low monthly payments on affordable 2-year rate plans from $45 a month. Plus, get deals on fashion and entertainment with member benefits. Visit virginmobile.ca for details. Some extra charges apply. Virgin Mobile, it's better to be a member. Yeah.